What's up, iHeart Country? It's Brett Young here, and this is an inside look at The Weeknd's Look a Little Different These Days album. You can check it out right here on iHeart Radio. Weeknd's Look a Little Different These Days is the title track of this new record, and it's just a nod, an acknowledgement to how much life has changed this year, how different this chapter is from any other chapter I've lived in my life. And it's an idea that I had one Saturday morning watching college football while my daughter was treating me like a recliner, laying on me in a diaper, drinking a bottle, watching college football Saturday with me. And that's where the realization started, was like, wow. You know, I think I even posted that picture to Instagram. I just went, wow, college football Saturday looks a lot different. And then I went, well, everything looks different now. Life is different. My priorities are different. And I had the idea for Weeknd's Look a Little Different These Days because I, rather than say college football Saturday, Weeknd's is when we're out on the road. And I started thinking about having my wife and baby on the bus when we're out touring. And I knew it was something that it wasn't going to be hard for not only existing parents to relate to, but aspiring parents and people that are like wondering what it's gonna be like when they finally enter into parenthood. And so it felt like another one that was really honest for me, but also would, you know, I think a lot of people need to hear, this is what it looks like for everybody. There is babies with messy hair and clothes and bottles and toys. Your living room doesn't, it's not your own anymore. It's a playpen, you know? And I think like giving people the license to be okay with that is a little bit what this song was about, to let everybody feel connected and know they're not going through it alone. And it just felt right to name the project that, because I think that's the most clear picture of what my life looks like right now. This is probably one of the most autobiographical songs on the record, only because it is right down the middle, true to this moment in my life and how I feel about my marriage and my relationship. We publicly, everybody knows about one breakup, but we, over the course of 12 years, had three breakups. All the while, for me, knowing that I wanted to be with this person, but the timing was wrong. And so not very many people get to come back from three misses to find the marriage and the life and the family that they wanted. It's pretty rare. And knowing that, I'm hyper aware of how lucky we are, but also how worth it was to go through all of the painful, hard moments to get here, because I don't think we could have had the honest conversation we had when we got back together, which was, if we're doing this again, we're getting married and starting a family. There's no more trying again. And that's kind of what that song's about, is the payoff that can come after a lot of like pain and heartbreak and work to get to where, you know, you want to be. And so it's a special song for me, and it's really right down the middle, exactly my life. Dear Me was an idea that I had because I remember what I felt like when I was missing Taylor when we were broken up. And I had this idea that, like, man, if I could have just told myself then what I know now, I would have settled down. You know, I wouldn't have been freaking out about it. I would have just been kind of leaning into it, for lack of a better phrase. And so it's pre-pandemic. We wrote this song on a songwriter's trip down in Florida almost 2 years ago now. I love going down there to write because you kind of shake off everything else that's going on, and you just, sometimes you get three songs a day. And this one was a later in the evening song where you felt like you're kind of burnt out on creative juices, and then I threw the idea out and it got everybody excited again, and their brains woke back up and they were ready to write again. And the second the demo was finished, we knew this was gonna make a record. And so being that Weeknd's Look a Little Different These Days is an attempt at full disclosure and honesty, this had to be the project that we put it on. And I think it's gonna be a sleeper on this record. I think it's gonna be a fan favorite. And so I'm excited to see what this does in the live show. So Leave Me Alone, is kind of our nod to Like I Loved You from the first record. It kind of did the same thing, where musically, if you didn't pay attention to the story being told, it makes you feel good. But if you dig in, there's this crazy contrast between what's being said and what you're feeling as a listener. It was a strange thing for me because it morphed into a different song. From the idea that I had for it and the title that I brought, to Jesse Frazier and Stephen Lee Olsen, which Jesse Frazier is the one that brings this really cool, it's almost like this beachy, happy vibe. The idea I had was really, again, about my experience with my breakups with Taylor, and it wasn't an angry idea. It was remembering when we broke up how important it was to cut off contact, because as long as we were talking to each other, we weren't actually moving on. And so that was the idea. It wasn't supposed to be angry. But the more we went into it, we saw that contrast between the music and the lyric, and we went, we can kind of go like I loved you with this. We can kind of get a little sassy with this if we want, and it won't feel that way, it'll just be that way. And that was one of those ones that took a while to have that realization and give ourselves permission to go a little bit sassy and angry almost. Before the song started falling out. But once we did, I mean, we all embraced that. And I think this is one where you need 3 to 5 listens to even recognize that it's an angry guy saying this. At first, it's just kind of, you get kind of lost in the music. And so it's gonna be a fun one for me. It's like one of those movies that every time you watch it, you pick up on something else. I think this song kind of has that dynamic to it. Not Yet is the closest thing that I've done to Sleep Without You, since Sleep Without You was my first single. And I the irony, it's not lost on me that I also wrote this with Justin Ebach and Kelly Archer, who I wrote Sleep Without You with. We have a lot of fun when we write together. And so the music is always gonna reflect the kind of vibe in the room. And we're always having fun when we're writing together. And so Not Yet was a title I had that was about a night that's going so well, you realize how well it's going, and you have that thought, I don't want this to end. It's like that same thing with a precious moment in your life where you're going like, I know it's only dinner time right now, but I wish this night could last forever. And so as we started talking about it and writing it, I found myself wanting to go to these little tricks that I like to use, play on words and get kind of heady and smart with it. And I kept getting steered away from that. And I realized that was the right thing, to go down the middle. And I think a story like this, if you don't get too specific in the story, if you just speak to the concept itself, you can speak to everybody in the world, because everybody's had moments like that in their life. For the most part, I over-listen to my music by the time it's released that I'm tired of it, and I put this on and it makes me feel good. And so the hope with this was that it would allow people to very easily connect to a moment that this song is for them in their past, in their life, and also just, you can turn your brain off and enjoy it as well. You Got Away With It was the closest thing to an accident I've ever had happen in a songwriter's room. I had that title, it was a play on words, You Got Away With It and You've Got Away With It, kind of morphing to be the same thing. I already knew I wanted to write that song, but this was another one of those songs that came out of a writer's retreat down in Florida. In fact, Dear Me was written the same day as You Got Away With It. And we were done for the day. We had already gotten 3 songs, and the guys went out, opened the door, and they were standing on the patio. And we had had a conversation about a worship song that I'm in love with called I Can Only Imagine. And I had just watched the movie. And so we had talked about that. And then they walked out on the patio and I started strumming the chords to I Can Only Imagine, but I was playing it muted. So like it just sounded kind of rhythmic. And Jimmy Robbins popped his head in the door and he goes, "What's that?" And I was like, "Nothing." And he goes, "Yep, it's the song we're writing tonight before we go to bed." And so they all came back in and they were excited about it. And Jimmy started building that track that's got kind of that swing and that kind of dirty, sexy thing to it. Even the harmonica you hear on the record was me playing like mouth trumpet into the microphone when we were writing it. We're just getting kind of weird with it. I didn't even throw out a title for it until Jimmy had already started building the music. And so I had that idea. We decided to make it kind of sexy, but also kind of dirty. Sonically, and it just felt like a thing that I had never done before on a record, that was a side of me I needed to show fans, because it wasn't foreign to me, but we hadn't shown that to people yet. And so what a fun one to release early. It's gonna be a great one for the live show. I'm excited about this one. You Didn't is, I think, almost as sad of a song as Mercy was. The irony there for me is that I was sad when I wrote Mercy and quite the opposite when I was writing this song. But I had 3 of my favorite songwriters with me, John Knight, Ashley Gourley, and Jimmy Robbins, who are all big fans of like kind of the R&B Boyz II Men era that I came up in. And so this was another one where we talked about what we wanted the vibe to be. We had written a couple songs already that day, and we just wanted to write an R&B ballad. So we just committed to do it, you know, and if it doesn't work out, it doesn't work out. And so I started digging for some titles and ideas that I had. And I think in the same way that it's interesting to write an angry, sad song over happy music, I think it's also just in a different way as interesting to write a breakup song where there is no anger. To be able to say like, you broke my heart, but I would have never wanted you to stay if this isn't where you were supposed to be. And I don't know that a lot of people in life will be able to walk away from a broken heart that way, but it does happen sometimes. And when it does, I think that's the most beautiful, truest depiction of love, is being able to say, I love you so much that I would never want you to stay if you weren't happy. I'm not mad at you, I don't hold anything against you. And that's what this song was. And we just chased down like a 90s Boyz II Men R&B vibe over this sweet breakup song, is all I can call it. And I'll never forget, when we landed that chorus, that tag in the first chorus, when we wrote that and sang it down, we all just kind of stood up and walked out of the room for a minute. It made us all feel something. And I think, you know, if you can manage to feel something when you're writing a song, then it's gonna get felt pretty hard by people when they hear it for the first time. And it felt really special. I'm praying and crossing my fingers that we can justify sending another ballad to country radio before we're off this project, because I think it's a special song.